visitors, distinguished guests to our great faculty here at the Citadel, friends and family, and most importantly, to the mighty class of 2014. Thank you so much for inviting me to share in this special day, this very important day in your lives. And I must tell you all right at the outset that it is so great for me to be back in Charleston. Yes, I say back in Charleston because I too have history here. I lived in Charleston during the period 2007 to 2010 when I was with SAIC in those years. And in fact, I served on the engineering school's advisory board during that period. I still have a house at the beach, and so it really feels like coming home to me. So thank you again. And General Rosa, before I get started any further, I have to also say that I am so humbled by having had this award of the honorary degree of Doctor in Aerospace Science bequested to me. It truly is an honor. It's really, really humbling. It's an extraordinary recognition. I certainly didn't expect it. And I have to also admit that I was really looking forward to hearing the conversations when I get back to the Pentagon about this new title, because you know, in a place like the Pentagon, titles and protocol and such, it really matters. So I'm only guessing what they must be thinking. What do we call her now? Do we call her Madam Secretary or Dr. Secretary or Madam Dr. Secretary? None of that quite sounds right, so we'll have to work on that. But you get my point. It'll be some fun going home. In January, when I was asked to deliver this commencement address, I was extraordinarily excited and I was really, really thrilled. But after I got over that initial thrill, it was never in my wildest dreams that I think that I would ever be standing before all of you here today. After I got over that initial thrill, I have to be honest, I began to be a little bit afraid. A seed of fear was planted in me. Because you see, I wondered what nugget of advice could I possibly impart upon this audience, to these wonderful graduates? What could I possibly give them that would help them in their lives as they go forward? So I've been thinking and thinking and thinking on this for a while, trying to come up with just the right thing. And the good news is I think I've got it. I think I've got it. But I'm not going to tell it to you right away, because no, sir, that's not the way these commencement speeches work. You have to listen to a few stories first, a few other pearls of wisdom perhaps, but I promise I will get to the point toward the end of my presentation. But really what I'd like to do for you today is tell you just a little bit more about some of the things that I've learned in my life. And again, I'll end with what I hope will be that important nugget that will help you all go forward as well. Now, in the Air Force, our Chief of Staff, General Mark Welsh, is fond of saying that every airman has a story. And I'm a new airman. I'm 4 months old on the job, and so I'd like to tell you just a little bit more about my own story. I was born and raised in New Jersey, and so it all started for me in a small town called Rumson, a very small town indeed. Looking back, it was a wonderful place to grow up, but it felt confining to me. It felt very, very small. And early on, the travel bug hit me, and I decided I wanted to see the world. So after high school, as you heard, I went to Duke, and then went on to graduate school at Columbia. My degrees were in international affairs. And I then left Columbia and moved down to Washington, D.C. And my dream was a very solid dream in those years. I wanted to join the State Department, and I wanted to be a Foreign Service Officer. And you see, based on my educational background and all the things I had done correctly to prepare myself, I just thought I was a shoo-in to get the job. And so I applied back in those years and waited for the acceptance letter to roll on in. But for whatever set of reasons, that wasn't in the cards for me. And in fact, the State Department didn't offer me a job back at that time. Well, this was pretty doggone disappointing, but I needed the money and I needed a job. And so I started applying for jobs elsewhere in the federal government. And the first job I landed happened to be with the Department of the Army through a program called the Presidential Management Intern Program. And at the time I became a civilian personnel in the Army, I had no particular knowledge about the military. I had no particular connection other than my dad had been a World War II veteran. And keep in mind, I was also deeply, deeply disappointed in these days because my dream of being a diplomat had been shattered. But I nonetheless soldiered on anyway. And then,
really, truly remarkable happened. It turned out that out of this first great disappointment in my young life, in my young life, just a year or two older than these graduates, this big disappointment changed the direction of my life and launched me on what has become a 30-year career in defense, including some really, really spectacular opportunities and challenges that I've been able to participate in. That 2 years I spent with the Army, I included a rotational assignment in President Reagan's White House. Then I got to go to Capitol Hill, 10 years, as a staff member on the House Armed Services Committee. And then 5 years in the Pentagon as an Assistant Secretary of Defense. My portfolio was the National Guard and Reserve Forces. And then I got out of government and went into the private sector. You heard some about my private sector experience. But what you didn't hear was that all throughout this period, I remained very, very involved with military groups, the Wounded Warriors Association, and the USO, and the Tragedy Assistance Program for Survivors. And now I've come back into government as the Secretary of the Air Force, which is the honor of my lifetime. And guess what? I have been traveling the world all along, and I'm not done yet. I've still got more to see. And so now, every time I bump into somebody in the State Department, I say, thank you, thank you, thank you for not picking me 30-some years ago, because I got to do the extraordinary things that I have had the opportunity to be involved with. So the first big lesson I would impart to all of you here today is be prepared to zigzag in your life. Be prepared to pivot when life throws you curveballs. Because I guarantee you, if you haven't already been thrown one or two, you certainly will be. But of course, I am talking to cadets here at the Citadel, and from what I hear tell, Jenkins Hall is throwing curveballs pretty much on a daily basis. So you all know how to pivot. There are both personal and professional curveballs that come our way, so even if you drop the ball from time to time when it's thrown your way, just pick it up as quickly as you can and keep on going. Because whatever your original idea is about what you want to do or the track that you think you want to take in life, it may or may not work out that way. So be prepared to seize whatever other opportunity comes your way and respond accordingly. Just remember, when one door closes, another door opens, and it's your job to walk through it. The second lesson I learned during my 30-plus years is that really when you come right down to it, everything comes down to the importance of people. This is because great people fuel all great organizations and institutions. As Secretary of the Air Force, I understand this better today than I have ever understood it in my entire life. As part of my new role, I've been trying to get out and meet our airmen where they work. And between you and me, this is truly my favorite part of the job. And I can report to all of you here assembled today that our airmen, our active duty, our National Guard, our reserves, and our civilians, they are doing an amazing job for us every day. So far, I've visited 28 bases in 18 states in the United States, including Joint Base Charleston just a few days ago. And I've been on an overseas trip to Afghanistan, Germany, and many of our other locations in the Middle East. And whenever I visit a location, I see leaders at every level taking on tough issues. I see superb teamwork and amazing, enthusiastic airmen who are most dedicated to the service of our great nation. Now I want to tell you a story about an airman I spoke with last week. He comes from the 106th Rescue Wing at Kopreski Air National Guard Base in New York. Sergeant Matthew Zimmer is a pararescue airman. In February of 2012, while deployed to Afghanistan, Sergeant Zimmer and his team responded quickly when the call came in that a military vehicle had been struck by an improvised explosive device, critically injuring 6 soldiers and trapping 2 of them inside the vehicle. Ignoring threats to his own life, Sergeant Zimmer went to their aid. Now imagine this, as he was trying to control the fire from within the vehicle and used what is called the jaws of life, picture huge pliers trying to open up the vehicle and extract the wounded. At this very moment, another IED exploded just 9 feet away, and that one wounded an explosive ordnance disposal technician. Recognizing that this injured tech was suffocating on his own blood and laying in the dirt, Sergeant Zimmer performed a field tracheotomy that allowed the tech to breathe on his own. He didn't stop there, however. He went back to that vehicle and the other casualties. And believe me, There were men who lived that day
that otherwise would have died.
Sergeant Zimmer is a shining example of the courageous and selfless airman who served our nation. And for his actions that day, Sergeant Zimmer earned a Bronze Star for Valor, which, by the way, was his second Bronze Star for Valor. He had already earned one previous times in Afghanistan. And he very gladly told me that he couldn't wait for next month, July, when he would be deploying yet again overseas. So these are the kinds of airmen that I get to meet every day, and their service and commitment really, really inspires me to work very hard for our Air Force and for our country while I have the privilege of serving in this position. And as a National Guardsman, Sergeant Zimmer is also the kind of person that you may come in contact with in your community. You may even be lucky enough to lead such an individual. So seek these people out in your life and ask them about their story. Ask them to be your mentor. You'll be amazed at what you can learn from them, and I know that I am. Remember, leadership is not a gift. You're going to have to work very hard at this, but fortunately you've had excellent training here at the Citadel. And as a leader entrusted to take care of those you supervise, your work is never complete. Throughout my career, I've heard the phrase, take care of your people, and the rest will take care of itself. And I can say to you today that with 99% certainty, 99% of the time, this is true. Whether it's business, or military, or academia, whatever walk of life you choose, when you give your people the right tools, resources, support, and guidance so that they can get their job done, you will be amazed at what they can accomplish. So lesson number two that I have learned in my life, always take care of your people. Seek out the honorable ones to be associated with, always. And that leads me to the third lesson that I have learned, and that's the importance of integrity. You've heard other speakers talk about that importance today, and I'd like to add a few words myself. I mentioned 99% a moment ago, and not 100% on purpose, because you see, throughout your life, there will be times when people let you down, both personally and professionally. But remember what I said about the curveballs? Well, 2 weeks ago, two weeks into my job as Secretary of the Air Force, I found out, talking about a curveball, I found out that dozens of young officers, they were missileers, they were implicated in a cheating incident at Malmstrom Air Force Base in Montana. And these are the launch officers who are responsible for our nuclear intercontinental ballistic missiles. So the fact that they were engaged in a cheating situation sounded very, very serious, and indeed, it was. Some, by the way, had actively cheated on this proficiency test, while others knew about it, and they did nothing to stop it. So I dropped everything I was doing, and I traveled out to those missile bases to try to find out what was really happening. And it turns out there were many, many factors involved, many things were going on, and there will be much good that comes out of this bad situation. And in the end, there were 10 leaders who were removed or retired from this incident, and over 90 missileers who were involved at some level will be held accountable. But here's the thing, though. The most troubling aspect of all of this to me was that people, even those who weren't involved with the cheating, there were those who knew about it and who didn't speak up, who didn't take action to stop it. Now, I know since becoming a NOB, you've learned to embrace the Citadel Honor Code. Cadet does not lie, steal, or cheat, nor tolerate those who do. These are 13 very, very powerful words. In the Air Force, we live by our core values. We call our core values integrity first, service before self, and excellence in all that we do. Every airman knows these, and these are the actions, these are the guide, you might say, that guide our actions in the Air Force. So whether you're serving in the military or entering the private sector, your values need to guide you for the rest of your life. The commitment to honor extends beyond the walls of the Citadel. In the Air Force, we put integrity first because we believe it's the foundation of everything else. It's the inner voice that leads us to do the right thing, even when the right thing is really hard, and even when no one is looking. Integrity, by the way, I consider to be deeply personal. But integrity is more than that. It's very much, in addition, a team sport. In the Air Force, we have a saying, take care of your wingmen. But being a good wingman does not mean protecting those who lack integrity or fail to uphold our core values Rather, it means not tolerating such actions. You see, when someone sacrifices their integrity, they introduce the tiniest seed of doubt into whatever context they're working, professionally or personally. And that seed of doubt may not land quickly or firmly, but it will land, I guarantee you, and it will make a crack. And that crack in the integrity of an organization or relationship can be very insidious if not fixed quickly. Some will shatter the foundation on impact, but others will start small, grow slowly, and be far-reaching until indeed the whole foundation crumbles. So my third lesson in life is that integrity is non-negotiable. It requires 100% from all of us all the time. Integrity matters. Which finally, at long last, brings me to the what I hope will be the nugget, the gift that I would like to give you. And this gift is not something that you can hold in your hands, but rather it's a philosophy that hopefully will help you through your life, and it certainly helped me through mine. So here's the one golden nugget of wisdom, and it really comes down to two words. To embrace any one of the lessons that I talked to you about today, here's what you have to do. You have to live bravely. Live bravely. Now that sounds simple, it's just two words, but it's really not simple at all, and it encompasses a great deal. To live bravely means to have the courage to live with integrity, the discipline to act in the presence of uncertainty, the perseverance to keep going and be able to zigzag in life when life throws you curveballs, the wisdom to surround yourself with good people and talented people, and then to cherish those people always. Live bravely. Now, I said that every airman has a story. Well, the Citadel is rich with stories of alumni who, since 1842, have chosen to breathe these words and seize their meaning. Graduates like Arlen Williams, class of 1957, whose actions on January 13, 1982, showed us what service really means. He was one of six people to survive when Air Florida Flight 90 crashed into the waters of the icy Potomac. Arlen chose to hand over rescue ropes to complete strangers. In the end, he sacrificed his life so that others could live. Graduates like Major Petra Lovatinska, class of 2000, who was one of the first four women to ever attend the Citadel, and who as a senior became one of only five people in the history of the United States to receive her citizenship as a special act of Congress so that she could serve as a U.S. Marine. Since graduation, she served honorably and she supported America's interests around the world. And finally, graduates like Air Force Captain Ryan Hall, class of 2004, who while deployed in support of Operation Enduring Freedom, made the ultimate sacrifice when the aircraft that he was in crashed. And this, of course, was just 2 short years ago. These Citadel graduates, like so many before them and after them, all chose to live bravely. As a parent myself, I want to also say, as I know the parents and the family members today who are with us, they have also lived bravely in their support of all of you, the graduates here today. And always, always you must remember them and honor them. Whether or not you realize it, you too, by being here today, by having gone through the 4 years that you've gone through at the Citadel, you too have shown your commitment to these two words. So please keep these two words close to your heart, especially in those times when fear, nervousness, or anxiety, when any of these things strike, whether it's on the battlefield or in the world of business, or in the world of government, or science, or technology. What you need to do is you need to reach down deep in your gut, and you need to feel that gold ring around your finger, and you need to remember this day. Remember, you are a graduate of the Citadel. You have, and you always will, live bravely. Congratulations to the class of 2000.
Thank you. Okay, I'm sorry.
Thank you for your service to our nation, and thank you for taking care of the many women of the greatest service. Thank you so much.
Here comes Mary, Mayor.
As all of you know, several graduates throughout the years have enjoyed a well-earned reputation for providing outstanding services to their nation and state. The ultimate expression of this selflessness has been through our graduates recognizing the needs of their country and answering the call to duty in the armed services. As one of only a few senior military colleges in the United States, the Citadel takes great pride in our graduates' military service to our nation. Citadel alumni have distinguished themselves in combat in every continent from the Civil War to present day. It's my distinct privilege to administer the oath of office to the men and women of class of 2014 for joining the military. By taking this oath, these young men and women are launching a career devoted to serving their nation. The gold bar they wear on their shoulder, either as a second lieutenant or an ensign, is symbolic of the trust their country has placed in them. They entered the Citadel grounds 4 years ago as Corps young members of the war class, and today they emerge as confident leaders capable of meeting any challenge and solving any problem. The lessons they've learned here will form the basis for all the decisions they will make, and they will be better leaders as a result. It's my honor now to administer the oath of office to the newest Citadel graduates to serve their country. All candidates to be commissioned, please rise.
Bachelor of Science from the School of Science and Mathematics.
authority vested in me by the General Assembly of the State of South Carolina as Chairman of the Board of Visitors of the Citadel, I confer upon each of you the baccalaureate degree for which you are qualified, with all the rights, duties, and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations to each one of you. Thank you for your time and service. Have a seat. School of Humanities and Social Sciences will now present the candidates for the Bachelor of Arts degree in the Humanities and Social Sciences.
I think Justin was supposed to stand.
Candidates for the degree in Bachelor of Arts in Criminal Justice, English, History, Modern Languages, Political Science, and Psychology. Please rise. Mr. Chairman, before you are the candidates for the degree of Bachelor of Arts from the School of Humanities and Social Sciences. The authority vested in me by the General Assembly of the State of South Carolina, as Chairman of the Board of Visitors of the Citadel, I confer upon each of you the baccalaureate degree for which you qualified, with all the duties, rights, and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations to each one of you. You may be seated.
Electrical Engineering, please rise.
by authority of the legislature of the state of South Carolina, as chairman of the provincial citizen, I confer upon each of you that agree that you qualified for with all the rights, duties, and privileges that pertain thereto. Congratulations to you, very tough members. Well, you know what time it is now. We will now present diplomas to the graduates. Mr. Sam Adams, the Associate Director of Alumni Affairs, will call the name of each graduate. The graduates will receive their degrees in the following order. The first and second honor graduates will receive their diplomas. Then diplomas will be presented alphabetically to all of our graduates. Day program graduates, cadets, those currently on active duty with the Armed Forces of the United States, veteran students, will all receive their degrees in alphabetical order. The last cadet receiving a diploma will deliver remarks. And the commissions and certificates for the armed services will be presented by Colonel Colombo, head of the Department of Aerospace Studies, Colonel Clark, head of the Department of Naval Science, and Colonel Huddle, head of the Department of Military Science. Will the first and second honor graduates please come forward?
Ryan Joseph O'Day, summa cum laude, first honor graduate, honors program participant. Donald Preston Hips, Jr., summa cum laude, second honor graduate, honors program participant. Francisco Javier Acosta, Jr., Spencer Adams, Michael Allender Adams, Jr., who will have his diploma presented by his father and his grandfather. Taylor Regan Addison, magna cum laude, honors program participant, who will have his diploma presented by his father. Bob Seabrook Algar, cum laude. Curtis Earl Allen, cum laude, Navy Commissionee. Jacob Gregory Allen. Alexander Sebastian Allendale. Jonathan Tyler Ammon. William Jones Andrews II. Vanessa Aponte. Royce Matthew Affling. Matthew Rutledge Aaron, cum laude, Navy Commissionee, who will have his diploma presented by his father. John Murphy Armstrong III. Michael John Armstrong. Elias Gaston Ashby, Army Commissionee. Christy Marie Oslani, Army Commissionee. James Forsyth Atkinson. Stephen Keith Valentine Jr., who will have his diploma presented by his father. Joshua Sean Bateman. Julian Antoine Baxter. Jesse Adam Bean. Adam Christopher Bear. Robert Michael Becker, Army Commissionee. Eric Matthew Benfield, cum laude. Dylan Ross Purple. Matthew Charles Bernard, cum laude, Navy Commissioner. Christopher Courtney Biggerstaff. Regis John Bigness, cum laude, honors board participant, Navy commissioning. Warren David Bixler. Garrett Alexander Blaze will have his diploma presented by his stepfather. Alexander Briard Blank, who will have his diploma presented by his father. Arthur Lee Blue, Army Commissioner. Logan Talmadge Bone. Mark Christopher Boozer. Rodney Sinclair Bostick. Zachary Allen Boyer. Jamal Akeem Brandon. Frederick Joseph Ricchetto III. Cum laude. Justin Tanner Bridges. Clayton Pafford Broom, Army Commissioner. Christopher Dwayne Brown, Air Force Commissioner. Valiant.